right, so moving on. My name's Chris. I'm an infrastructure geek. The other way I describe myself is I'm a failed scientist. I started out doing computational biology, but in the 90s, all of my peers, we all had to write the tools to get our job done. So unlike my peers who went on to become real grown-ups and real scientists, I sort of wrote some pretty bad software, and then I needed iron to run my software on, and took a look around my company. There was only Nobel-certified IT people and Windows-certified IT people. No one knew Unix, no one knew how to try performance computing, so I had fantastic management. My management gave me $2 million from the R&D budget. I built a data center, and sort of roughly about 15 years ago, I made a very quick career transition from entry-level scientist to quite poor scientific software developer to really sort of infrastructure IT nerd, and for almost 20 years, I've been doing sort of let's put it this way, computers are boring. Computers combined with science is what makes it interesting for me. So I've spent most of my career doing sort of infrastructure and IT work directly supporting sort of demanding production life science discovery environments. So the really cool thing is BioTeam is a collection of people just like myself. I don't want to do the sales pitch up here, but the reason for throwing this slide up here is the reason why people like me get invited to events like this is that the nice thing about the consulting model is we're in and out of dozens of shops every year. Most of our customers allow us to speak about what we can see and do. And so if you're looking for someone to give kind of an industry trend or a brain dump, the consulting folks are usually a good model because we get to see how many different smart people tackle similar problems, and we can sort of identify the common points or the interesting derivatives as well. The other thing to mention is that we've grown from the original couple of BioTeam. This is the full roster of BioTeam minus two. It's not unexpected that we'll be more than 20 by the end of this year. But the other reason why I threw this slide out is I'm directly calling out the BioTeam employees in the room. Frankly, it's ridiculous in 2016 that I'm still up here doing this stuff. I know we did some workshops and other things earlier in the week, but next year I expect every BioTeam person to be up here giving a talk at some point in BioIT World. Frankly, when we get together in the room tomorrow for our all-hands meeting, honestly, I'm going to be the dumbest guy in the room. Like, if you guys could hear what my colleagues are doing, the crazy stuff that we're doing, half of it I don't even hear about because they're working on government gigs or other gigs that, I don't really see because I'm wrapped up in some of my pharma or biotech work. So consider yourself challenged, folks, and we're moving on. So the other thing to mention, and I'm getting into sort of talking about why I'm in, like, a little bit of a midlife crisis mode here, is I've been here a lot. I've been going through these slides. The earliest trend slide I can find dates back to 2010, but there's some indications that I've been talking about this stuff since about 2007, 2008, if you include like the Harvard Biomedical HPC Leadership Forum and some other stuff. And I'm getting a little bit worried about that, so hence the midlife crisis time. So actually, if you remember the 20-person slide, this is BioTeam in 2002. So we went from 4 to almost 20 relatively quickly. So the genesis for my fear is that unfortunately, I don't get sexy new trends and sexy new pain points every single year, and I can't give you a completely different talk every year. And I've been doing this long enough that I'm a little bit worried that you're hearing the same damn thing over and over again and seeing many of the same slides over again. So I put up a little survey here. I'm sort of thinking about radically changing up the format in other years. Right now, we try to do a quick hit survey of sort of as many, many topics as we can in 40 or 45 minutes. Another option is to kind of skip the boring stuff and concentrate on two or three things in more technical detail. Another option is just to bring someone else up on stage and to have someone else with a different viewpoint and perspective do the trends. So if you like this stuff, if you're interested in more sort of practical trends type stuff, please fill out the CHI and BioIT World survey. But if you can, hit our survey site and let us know what you think. In particular, I think it's really, I should ask, for a show of hands, how many people have seen me do a trends talk before? All right, see, that's the reason why I'm a little bit worried about it. So, honestly, it's your honest feedback that will sort of help. The blunt truth is that a lot of the trends are now constant pain points, or they're just facts of life in our reality. So I repeat the material, but in many cases, it's often to new audiences or to people who need this material to go to their management and justify a purchase or procurement decisions. So with that said, I changed up. This is the meta slide. I always introduce every one of my talks to sort of explain the existential dread that IT people in our world sort of have to deal with every day. The blunt truth is, if you want to understand what drives people like me, it's that we have to deal with an environment where the lab side science is changing month to month. And my most aggressive, best funded biotech customers can refresh their data centers or infrastructures every 2 years. I talk to scientists these days, and a senior scientist, she can't tell me what she's going to be doing 6 months down the road. The rate of innovation in instrumentation, lab protocols, and just basic biology is just blowing away with how fast it's going. And frankly, we can't change our infrastructures fast enough. So the existential dread for IT people in my world is that if I'm going to do right by my customers, I have to design, deploy, and support infrastructures that will do science for 2 to 5 to 7 years in the face of a scientific environment where the researchers can't really articulate what they're going to be doing beyond 6 months from now. So it really is kind of a constant sort of low-grade fear, because if you screw it up, you affect your business, you affect your competitive ability, you upset scientists, and scientists are, they're not careful about expressing their displeasure. If you screw them up and let them down, you'll know very, very quickly. So this is a set of slides that I was thinking about taking out, but the more and more of it is that when it comes to DevOps and automation and orchestration, every single BioTeam project in 2015 involved some level of orchestration and configuration. So I figure this is worth a little bit recycling, but I'm going to stun you senseless with how fast I go. This will be the sort of seizure mode of the presentation. So, you know, the blunt truth for the IT admins, this has been true for a long time. If you're an IT administrator and you can't code or script, your career is done. You're going to have trouble finding a rewarding career path, you know, in the future. It's not just cloud. It's this sort of API-driven, virtualization-driven, automated stuff. It's everywhere. Everything we touch, everything we manipulate is rapidly on track to have an API. And the days of sort of point-and-click sysadmin are sort of over. You've got, you know, and you don't have to be a software engineer. You just have to be able to do a little scripting. If you're Windows, that means PowerShell. If you're Unix, that means, you know, Perl, Python, Ruby, you know, whatever you like. You've got to be able to do a little bit of scripting if you're going to take advantage of the sort of wave of automation that's happening. I've already talked about this a little bit, but, you know, this stuff is already in your company. And if it's not in your company or organization, your leadership is doing something wrong. So the upside is that if you do learn this stuff, you will be incredibly effective. You'll get way more done with less time. And the bonus thing is, you know, your LinkedIn profile views will go up a couple 100%. my personal experience with this, I got one of the Amazon fairly hard to get certificates. And the day I put that on the LinkedIn profile, you know, everybody's looking for certain skills, and DevOps and automation stuff definitely in that same world. So for companies, we're not on the cloud yet is not really a viable excuse. Like I said, these tools are available today for use in your company, and it's a mistake to not to be using them in 2016. It's already a transformative disruptor in our world. It's the word, you know, we like to use, it's a little bit of a cliche, but it's a force multiplier. It's, you know, automation, orchestration, configuration management. It allows a team of one or two people to manage fleets of what could be hundreds of thousands of servers or really, really complicated and reconfigurable scientific computing environments. So not using these methods in 2016 implies a certain legacy mindset about either your leadership or your corporate culture, and that's starting to have a little bit of a taint these days as well. So you want to watch out for that. And finally, your competitors probably don't. So that's another reason why I sort of, you know, think long and hard about what you guys are doing. So the interesting thing about DevOps and configuration management is that it really doesn't matter what you use. They're all good. They're all really, really durable. The most important thing is that you pick one and you standardize on it. And ideally, you want to standardize on it beyond research. It's kind of a pain in the butt when research has become a chef shop and enterprise has become a puppet shop. So you kind of want to nip that in the bud, because one of the biggest advantages of this DevOps stuff is trading playbooks, trading recipes, trading expertise. And if the enterprise people are using a different, you know, platform and you're using something else in research, it's a little bit harder to gain sort of, you know, best bang for the buck out of your orchestration stack. So the other thing I want to mention is, if you're interested in this stuff, the BioTeam people are quite good at this. And so we've got Chef, Puppet, Ansible, SaltStack, all kinds of experts hanging around in the booth. And in particular, if you want to see a neat way that we're using automation magic with this little $30 wireless dongle to configure servers via tablets and iPhones, stop by the booth and talk to Aaron Gardner. The videos that I've seen, the demos are pretty slick. So, you know, adding ad hoc wireless to a server for the purpose of configuring it and getting it up to speed or pushing out updates has been really, really interesting in our world. And I think that the appliance is interesting, but the way we configure and manage the appliance is equally interesting for certain people in the room here. So same thing goes to networking people. I'm going to skip this. It's just to say that you've got some time if you're a networking person, but you're not going to be able to coast on a Cisco cert for much longer. You know, OpenFlow, software-defined networking, API, it's all going into. And actually, the value of Cisco people is probably going to go down a little bit over time. In Greenfield and new networking projects, Cisco was not often the first choice. So there's emerging opportunities to get skilled up on different vendors, different platforms, different types of silicon as well. So this is a new slide, and this sort of came out a lot of the sort of assessment and interviews with scientists that I've been doing over the past year. So what you're starting to see on the lab side is that more and more of the mainstream research users are dealing with data volumes or data complexity that go beyond what you can do with macros and spreadsheets. So we're starting to see normal, you know, molecular biologists, microscopy people, scientist people, we're starting to have to pick up a little bit more in the way of analytics. You know, it's not to say that they have to become full-on data scientists, but we're at the point now where the sort of data explosion in our world has reached, it's sort of diffused everywhere into the lab side, and you know, the traditional methods of sending spreadsheets or comma-separated value files around, they're not long for this world, I think, in many industries, or sort of many scientific areas where previously they were getting by with very, very simplistic data management methods. The other thing to mention is, you know, data scientist is probably the hottest new career or hottest new title you can find. It has a little bit of the sort of taint that we saw from grid computing or even bioinformatics in the 90s, and that unfortunately buzz attracts the sort of poorer certificate mills and diploma schools, and there's a little bit of a warning here that you sort of have to watch out for the people who sort of rubber stamp or stamp out data scientist credentials. What I found, because I've had the opportunity to sit down and work with expert level data scientists, is that it's not magic. You don't need to hire a unicorn. You know, the skills are definitely attainable. You just have to work for them. But the real value of a data scientist is not that they know the data transformation and analytics techniques. It's that they know your domain, they know your science, they know your data, and then they know how to take that domain expertise and apply the transformation and analytics skills. So I think the skills are easy to acquire. Like I said, you don't have to worry about hiring ninjas or unicorns. I think you have to worry a little bit. You're starting to see signs of kind of certificate mills in this space where people are just kind of putting data scientists on their CV. But the blunt truth is, when you're looking for these people, I think you can train up the analytics skills. What you're looking for is people who actually understand the domain, because that's where the value of sort of getting data out of these systems really come from. The other one, and Duan at the Broad will talk your ear off about this. There's people who've been dealing with this for a long time. It is not as sexy, it is not as well known, but there is a massive and growing trend. And honestly, I have to say, this is probably the direction that my career might be taking over the next couple of years. And that there's an emerging need for people who are not data scientists or they're not traditional administrators, but people who understand how to manipulate, move, ingest, export, and sort of shift around vast piles of data. And you're starting to find that there's kind of a new job category here, and it's actually kind of a fun category. And you're starting to see, I think, data engineer is sort of the common applied setting for that at this point. So I'll jump into compute. The compute stuff is a little bit new because honestly, not a lot has changed in compute. I really do feel that scientific computing feels like, from an IT perspective, it's a solved problem. It's easy to acquire the compute power you need. It doesn't matter if it's virtual, on-prem, in the cloud. It's commoditized to the point where it costs roughly the same. It doesn't matter if you buy it from Dell or HP or IBM or the cool folks at Silicon Mechanics. So generally speaking, compute hasn't been a headache in our world for quite some time. There's some edge cases and things I'll talk about, but it's not particularly a nasty pain point for us and hasn't been in quite some time. So one of the things I've mentioned is that this is something I have discovered repeatedly in sort of assessment work and interviewing scientists, is that there is an emerging class of lab-side scientists who are being left adrift and ignored by both HPC and IT, and it's starting to become a productivity problem, and it's going to become an employee retention problem in the near future. What it really boils down to is that more and more laboratory instrumentation is requiring fairly high levels of workstations to process the data or even control the instrument. The problem is that they're in this limbo zone where their computing and storage needs are small enough that they're ignored or they've never interacted with the HPC folks, but the needs are so large that it doesn't fit. They can't run the instrument software, the analysis software, on their personal desktops or workstation. So what I'm finding is very, very expensive, highly skilled PhD-level scientists who are spending 6 to 8 hours tethered to a wet lab. They can't go to their office and work. They can't even go home and work over a VPN because the software that they need to use only runs on an instrument attached to a lab-side workstation. I've found this repeatedly enough that I think it's a capability gap. And when you talk to the poor people who are sort of tethered to the wet lab and can't even go back to their office, they're in a sad state. So something's got to be done in this regard. I suspect the solution is some sort of VDI or virtualization approach. But there's this emerging trend. Every single time an instrument gets upgraded, you end up with this potential where the analysis side is not big enough that it needs to run on HPC, but it's too powerful for them to run on their laptop or their corporate endpoint. And I've already talked over this slide, so I'm just going to skip it. But like I said, it's a productivity and morale issue today. It's going to become an employee retention problem in the future if we don't solve it. So the specific example, and I like this because flow cytometry used to be simple. These things were just boxes that counted stuff. And the amount of data that came out of a flow cytometer a couple years ago, it never even ever came on my roadmap. Now you've got this image stream X, which has multiple lasers, multiple frequencies, and is taking HD photos of every single cell that flows down the wire. This is a perfect example of sort of a it's not forgotten, but people didn't pay a lot of attention to cytometry in the past because the needs were quite small. Now all of a sudden, new package, new sensor, and we've got, you know, terabyte volumes of data coming out of this thing, and analysis requirements that tether the scientists to the wet lab. So this is just one of sort of many examples that are happening at sort of the lab side instruments, you know, scale up, but they're not quite brought into the HPC fold. So moving on a little bit to compute, again, this is an emerging trend, and this is across probably five of my biotech customers, and maybe two or three of my pharma customers, is that what you're starting to see is HPC is going way beyond research now. There are explicit mandates to expose high-performance computing as a service that can be consumed across the enterprise. And that includes manufacturing, commercial operations, the mobile sales force, everything else. And that is really interesting, but it has a very interesting effect on the way we buy, design, roll out, and support our HPC environments. And I want to talk a little bit more about that in the future slide. The other trend that you're starting to see, and there's people here, I won't name the pharmas because I didn't go through public disclosure review, but everybody is trying to put APIs on top of HPC. Everybody is trying to build common sets of APIs to sort of access data, sort of move towards this sort of compute and data commons. You're starting to see it just universally across. So the take-home message here is HPC has grown up. It's mainstream now. We've got to sort of expose it as a service to the enterprise. And that has an interesting effect on what we build, buy, borrow, and operate. And so I've already talked about this thing. So when you have to roll out HPC across the enterprise, you can't assume that your users are coming from a university environment where they had, you know, a login account on a system with 40,000 cores. There's a required investment in training, onboarding, knowledge transferring, embedding consultants into the organization so that they can make effective use of the systems that you've built. Not a lot of these people are comfortable at the Linux command line, so there's more and more of a focus on building automated workflows, you know, stamped out templates, and even just portals where you can point and click through this. On the API side, I'm seeing probably a roughly equal mix between people sort of building on top of what Univa is doing with their Grid Engine product, a lot of people building homegrown APIs that are customized to their needs, and then it's unfortunately blued out in that URL, but agaveapi.co is interesting in that it's a successful, large-scale, big science set of APIs that you're starting to see being deployed in sort of internal enterprise environments as well. So I want to talk a little bit about how this specifically affects hardware now that we have to build HPC environments that are going to be consumed by the enterprise. So a little bit of history here. In research, the easiest way to say this in research is that research does not require five nines of uptime. We will happily go down for a day, go down for a couple of hours, if it means we can save a few hundred thousand dollars or even $1 million or more on redundant hardware. We will always choose bigger, better, faster, and we will sacrifice on redundancy because discovery-oriented research isn't typically mission critical. Yeah, it's annoying to go down for a few hours or a day, but it's not catastrophic. That doesn't fly when your HPC has to be consumed across the enterprise. That doesn't fly when you're trying to play in the enterprise world with SLAs and 24/7 uptime agreements. So give you one specific example here, and just tease you with this little picture here and ask you if you see anything different, and then I'm just going to quickly go to the answer here. So prior to 2015, I would only buy one of these switches. I don't care about redundancy. I don't care about full path diversity and redundant routes back to the core. However, now that we have to build HPC environments that are 24/7 with SLAs, we're now doubling the switchgear that we're buying. We're not oversubscribing our links, and we're building in far, far, far more levels of sort of high availability technology that R&D, frankly, we saved tons of money by bypassing this stuff, and we can't do that anymore. Fortunately, I think someone other than R&D is going to have to pay for this. If enterprise wants to consume HPC resources, I think enterprise needs to kick in the budget so that we can meet their SLAs and uptime requirements. So a little bit more on compute stuff. One of the things, and I've talked about this a little bit, is that if you buy into my meta problem that we have to design infrastructure that survives 2 to 5 years in the face of science that's changing month to month, you have to be worried about Hadoop and big data and data lake and analytics. And in particular, in the Hadoop world, there's a interesting stretch on the type of hardware that you buy. In Hadoop, if you're running HDFS, they really, really, really like it when you have tons and tons of disk drives attached to your server so you can have really, really good HDFS across your environment. That doesn't match well with blades and high-density servers connected with 10 gig links back to a network file store, which is normally what we would do for traditional HPC. So there's an interesting set of hardware here, and I'm just calling out HP's Apollo, the 2000 and 4000 series stuff. So this is a 2U chassis, and up front there's 24 drives. The really cool thing about this is that every one of those 24 drives can be individually mapped to any one of the servers that's in the chassis. So it's a 2U chassis that gives you a lot of flexibility in sort of how you allocate I/O. You can buy this chassis empty and add disks if you need it, if you need to support Hadoop or HDFS in the future. And then on the back, you've got blade-like density without paying sort of a blade packaging premium. So I'm really sort of liking this kind of packaging where it's disk-heavy up front, but server-heavy as well, and allows me to hedge my bets. I can use this type of hardware to support traditional high-performance computing, but I can also build out a pretty badass data lake or Hadoop environment as well. And it's a nice set of reconfigurable, repurposable hardware. And I think you're starting to see that in procurement and purchasing trends over time. So a little bit on sort of new stuff, and I'm going to talk specifically about data lakes and Hadoop that's secure and multi-tenant. So this is it's actually a major trend. I'd say probably we're well past the 50% threshold among sort of BioTeam friends and clients who are actually running production workloads on big data platforms. I still think that, and it's just like HPC, these capabilities are being marketed way beyond research. If you're going to run a Hadoop or a Spark cluster or a data lake, you're probably going to be exposing it to people beyond R&D. The other interesting trend is whether or not you're running these workloads on the cloud or on-prem. A lot of these requirements snuck up quick enough that a lot of people just decided to go cloud first for their sort of Hadoop workloads. But I think from what I can tell and from talking among my friends and clients, there's a roughly 70-30 split between cloud and on-prem, with cloud being the 70% and 30% being on-prem. There is a significant potential, I think, for wasted resources. Just like cloud, the whole big data thing is ripe with vendor lies and hype and overselling of stuff that's not quite reasonable yet. So I think that you need to approach it with caution. It's producing usable, viable results today, but you need to be careful about it and you need to bring the right skills. This is not something that can really be mandated by the C-level office down. You've got to have a use case, you've got to have a technology stack, and you've got to know what to do with it. It's not a magic box that's going to be producing amazing insights for your enterprise without real work. So, and I've talked about this again, I still think, you are getting usable, actionable results, but in order to do that, I think one of my biggest problems with Hadoop and big data analytics is how badly the marketers undersell the difficulty of use. A lot of the sales materials are just, they're just a lot of hand-wavy stuff about, look how magically you can ask really interesting questions against your data, and poof, you get actionable insights. That is just not true. You don't have to be a ninja, you don't have to be a unicorn, but you have to understand the domain, you have to understand the data, you have to understand the transformations, the data structures. You're probably going to need to understand a little bit of SQL, a little bit of statistics, and a little bit of visualization if you're actually going to ask meaningful questions and get results out. So my cynical take on big data analytics right now is people are really underselling, they're overselling on ease of use. You need to be fairly skilled to get interesting data out of this environment. It's not magic, and anyone who is selling you an appliance, I would say be a little bit cynical. And what you want to do with the vendors is there's a lot of carefully constructed fake demos and use cases, and you want to get beyond the demos and go in. You want to try this stuff or proof of concept it with real data and real questions before you buy into this ecosystem. The other thing to mention particularly is that a lot of this action is centered around the Apache Hadoop ecosystem, and I want to give you sort of two quick anecdotes from dealing with all the stuff in the Apache Foundation stack. So the interesting thing about Apache is that it's all open source, it's all free, it's easy to deploy on-prem, it's easy to deploy on the cloud. The downside is that there's about 30 different projects all being run by different teams of developers with different release cycles and different levels of software maturity. So you have to be very careful about picking and choosing the sort of product mix that you want to bring to bear. And there's one particular example that I want to talk about, which is this really cool thing called Zeppelin, which is basically a web-based data science notebook. It's incredibly approachable and very useful. Every time, talk to some of the BioGen people here, and they'll tell you every time they show Zeppelin to an end user, there's just an instant desire to get access to it. The problem is, and actually, so let me see here. So this is just an example of the sort of Zeppelin notebook. The problem here is that Zeppelin is still an incubator stage project within Apache, and this presents a little bit of a challenge when trying to deploy it in an enterprise environment. And I'll try to summarize all the words that are on the slide. Long story short, Zeppelin was created with no concept of multiple users, and the default Zeppelin server has access to everybody's notebook, everybody's data. You can read, write, you can do whatever you want. So it's an amazing tool if you have one user who owns one cluster, It's fairly problematic if you wanted to sort of deploy it in a multi-user environment, particularly if you have security concerns around who can see what data. So there's all sorts of hoops you have to jump through. A lot of people went down the sort of Docker containerization route. We ended up, basically, for every data scientist who wants to use Zeppelin, we have to do a separate sandbox install, and we have to do a lot of work to sort of handle the authentication and the sort of resource isolation. So honestly, it's not a hard example. It's really not a hard problem. It's just I wanted to give you an example of what happens when you're dealing with an open source ecosystem where the individual components are being developed at rapidly different rates. So Zeppelin is really, really good, but from a development perspective, there's work that we need to do to sort of integrate it into a multi-user environment. The other example is securing for enterprise use. Hadoop, data lakes, you know, that stuff, really, really easy if you don't have data sensitivity requirements, if you have one user or a couple of common workflows. However, it gets a little bit harder to implement when the enterprise suits come in with all of their checkboxes around role-based access control, full Kerberization, Active Directory integration, encryption everywhere, audit trails, compliance, governance, and testing. So the interesting thing is that, again, it's not particularly hard to build a really, really hardened, Kerberized, encrypted, role-based access control. You just have to be very, very careful about the components you pick and the way that you test them. And there's one cliche example here is that there was one particular piece of the stack that we had assumed that we were going to use, which was Hive. And it turns out, at this point, Hive has difficulty integrating with Knox, which is a gateway that secures all of your API-level calls. So in our security standpoint, the use of Knox is mandatory. We will not allow an unauthenticated API call against the data lake environment. So if Hive doesn't support Knox, we knock Hive out of the environment and we have to find and deploy a suitable replacement. So again, not rocket science, not particularly hard, but it's the little things that you sort of have to think about, and sort of particularly when you're trying to build multi-tenant, multi-user, highly secured, you know, highly sort of audit trailed, you know, Hadoop-y type environments. So that was it on the sort of compute side, and I'll switch a little bit into storage, and I'll talk a little bit. I think the old stuff, you know, none of this has really changed. I think from a storage vendor perspective, the thing about our environment is that we have all of the data types, and the reason why this is problematic is that you will very carefully understand or very quickly understand that storage products are typically architected to be very good at one or two good things. There are very few storage products that are universally good at all of the different use cases here. Data curation is still important. I'm still the guy standing up on stage saying, if you have more than a petabyte of data in your organization and you don't have a full-time employee managing it, you're wasting more in storage CapEx dollars than the fully loaded cost of an employee to sort of curate and wrangle your data. The other thing that's a pet peeve of mine is I still see people talking about disk-based data movement and physical media ingest as if it's easy. It's not. It's easy if you do it badly or do it poorly. It's hard to do it carefully with full protection and ND5 checksums on every end of the data transfer. So there's a lot of issues about physical media movement that I think in research we're not particularly talking about, because it's really easy to talk to your manager or talk in a meeting about, yeah, we're just going to ship a disk drive around. But when you actually start to think about and turn physical media ingest into an SOP procedure, it's really quite hard. So I'm definitely one of the people who comes down strongly in favor of network-based data movement. There's too much risk, there's too much operational burden, and frankly, it's just too much work to do you know, physical media ingest. Although, I will have to say, I've got two pharmaceutical customers that I believe have a real-world use for the AWS Snowball, which is the sort of portable multi-terabyte encapsulated data movement box, and I'm kind of psyched that I'm fairly certain I'm going to be hands-on with Snowball in a couple of months. So storage stuff, I mean, really, even if you're not in the cloud, you need a cloud storage strategy, not the least of which is that you know, object-based storage in the cloud is increasingly becoming a more and more viable way that you're exchanging data with collaborators or ingesting data from outside providers or data brokers. So even if you have no intent to operate on a cloud, you have to start thinking about the cloud as a mechanism by which you might be putting, getting, or exchanging data with people. A little bit more on the trend side, that's becoming slightly more real in 2016. I talked about this before, but you know, we really are at a point now where the friction required to download or generate data is far lower than the cost of storing that data and keeping it safe. There are petabytes of open access information available on the internet now, it would be a totally reasonable scientific or business request for a scientist to want to download chunks of that data and do interesting things with it. However, the ease at which she can express interest in that data set has to be balanced against the incredible cost of bringing that data in, managing the ingest, and sort of dealing with how to keep it safe. So we're increasingly entering an era where you need governance around even big, non-important data sets. I think we're well past the point where a research user needs to provide a business or scientific justification for, you know, more than a few terabytes of storage or more than storage of, you know, particular size X. The other issue is data diffusion. For a long time, I got away with assuming that compute, storage, and big data generating instruments like genome sequencers would be centralized. We have absolutely lost that battle. High data rate consumers and high data rate producers are just effectively diffused like smog throughout our organization. They're in offices, they're in wet labs, they're in loading docks. You can no longer assume that all of your big data instruments, either producers or consumers, are going to be in one centrally managed place that you can sort of look at from an infrastructure perspective. You sort of have to come to grips with the reality that as these instruments get cheaper, better, faster, more and more people are going to buy them, and they're going to start ending up under desks in offices and in wet labs that you've ignored for years from a networking perspective. I do need to mention a beer because it actually has been a little bit of a trend. Since I talked about them last year, I probably have 10 customers that have gone from proof of concept to production on them. So I don't want to read a beer or do a sales pitch for them, but the interesting thing about a beer and why you're starting to see action in this space is that they sort of solve six pain points related to storage management and life science in one appliance. So from a capability perspective, they're fairly interesting. And from a success perspective, they've had some pretty good wins in our field. So the other stuff that's a little bit new and interesting in 2016, although the storage geeks in the room probably have already seen this, this was going all over Reddit and Hacker News 2 weeks ago. If you really want to read a really interesting postmortem on what happens when a 1.7 petabyte file system goes down and all of the heroics required to recover most of that data, the folks at csc.fi wrote a really, really great postmortem. It also re-influences some of my own internal biases about where and how best to use parallel and distributed file systems. So Storage Geeks, you should check that out if you haven't seen it already. It's a fantastic sort of news story. This is probably the biggest take-home slide for the storage part of the deck. We are at a point now where there is a tremendous amount of big scientific storage that is approaching a 3 to 5 year lifespan. I personally have 4 separate projects that are deeply looking at complete refresh or complete replacements of the incumbent storage platform. The drivers are coming from all sorts of places. It's cost, it's object, it's cloud, it's the amazing results you can get out of commodity hardware supporting software-based storage. It's all the disruptive stuff. I think vendors should be scared and vendors should be excited. There is going to be a fundamental change in the storage landscape between 2016 and 2017 and 2018. There's incumbent vendors that are going to get wiped out. There are incumbent vendors that will reinforce their dominant market position. And there's tremendous opportunity for some of the new disruptive players. I'd be interested in knowing after this talk how many of you agree with me. I just think that my sense of the industry right now is there's an amazing install base of stuff that's about 3 to 5 years old. And there's a lot of people really, really looking at what the future's going to look like. So the other thing that's happening is that, again, like I said, this is just an example. There's all sorts of interesting players coming out of scale-up NAS. There's really interesting sort of pure software running on commodity hardware stuff. There's companies like Igneous, which I think talked yesterday, doing really interesting sort of next-gen on-prem object store. From our perspective, I've ignored Flash for a long time because the cost was never approachable relative to the amounts of data that I needed to store. You're starting to see trends in pricing where Flash is not just for your data transfer node or ingest node or scraps tier. You're starting to see a little bit more mainstream usage. And then there's always cool stories coming out of the, for instance, the one we like is Intel and Panetta did a really amazing project, which is basically a couple of petabytes of Lustre on ZFS, incredibly green, incredibly energy efficient, and amortized out over 5 years, it actually turns out to be cheaper than Amazon Glacier. And so the other thing I should mention, and I don't exactly have the dates, but the Panetta Lab is doing a free disruptive storage workshop where they're going to allow people to get hands-on, and they're going to talk about their sort of route for doing inexpensive commodity storage. And I guess find us at the BioTeam booth or look up the Panetta Lab online if you're interested in that. There's going to be at least one interesting workshop coming up where they're going to disclose their materials and methods. So this is new, and I want to talk, this is something that I've been sort of pondering for the last couple of months, and it really boils down to this concept that, storage is cheap. You can buy petabytes of disk from many, many vendors these days. It's the metadata that's precious, and I want to give you a couple of war stories about just how much of a pain in the ass it is to sort of get this metadata and sort of understand what we're actually storing now at this point. So a couple of war stories from, people who are sort of heroically trying to figure out what the heck are we storing on our file systems these days. So, example number one is a pharmaceutical company with a multi-petabyte EMC install. They took Robinhood, which is open source software hosted on SourceForge. They crawled their database, they crawled their file system, put a bunch of results into a MariaDB database. It took over 8 days to walk the file system. Re-indexing or re-walking the file system actually takes longer because now they have to update database records. So a tremendous amount of engineering and time required to walk the multi-petabyte file system. The results were really, really interesting. This is just a quick summary, but I'll show you the more interesting bits, I think, on the next slide. So this is some interesting data. Top user had 327 terabytes. Top 10 users responsible for 93% of all the data. Really, really interesting data. Only about 30 terabytes of the entire 1.2 petabyte archive was in any way active or moving in any significant way. And the majority of data was never ever accessed or read after it was written the first time. And it included tremendous amounts of copies of public and sort of non-valuable data. And so this required a significant amount of work. One of the things I want to mention is that you don't get this type of analytics out of the box from a vendor. It doesn't, there's some company, you can get VMs and stuff, but at the end of the day, if you really want to understand what you're storing, you've got to do a little bit of legwork, and you might have to engineer some systems around it. The particular reason why this was worthwhile is that this sort of proved the concept that we were using a very, very expensive tier one storage system, and scientists were effectively treating it as a dumping ground for what I would say is crap data. So this sort of proves the use case for a new storage tier. It sort of proves the use case for maybe considering alternative storage directions. So it was worth it. The time required to engineer this, the time required to walk the file system, delivered actionable results that will materially affect what this pharmaceutical company does with their storage platform in the near future. The second example is a slightly different approach. This is an organization that's, again, has about 5 petabytes of Isilon, but they're sitting behind in the Vera cluster. I can't talk about the results because the work is ongoing right now, but they previously tried the file system walk with database thing, and they hit the wall after 500 million records, and they had to come up with something new. So these guys are doing something really, really cool. The first thing that they do is they walk the file system with a C application called PWalk. But what they do is the PWalk jobs are supported, the PWalk tasks are submitted as normal HPC jobs to the grid environment. So the file system crawling happens intermixed with live scientific compute being done. So every PWalk job runs as an HPC job, it writes to a unique log file. There's a heavily optimized load phase where the log files are read in parallel and they're sent to a big Redis NoSQL store. The primary key is the full path to the file system object directory or pointer. And the record that they store is the sort of file stats, size, last access time, ownership group, plus a hash map of the relationships are. The interesting thing about this is that by putting the data into Redis, they can effectively pre-compute the answers to every possible storage question that they would like to ask. So the walk stage, the ingest, and the compute stage is fairly hardcore. Being able to interactively browse through the data is really, really quick because of the key value relationships. The answers that you're looking for are effectively pre-computed. You don't have to wait on big database indices or big table scan to actually go through. So I think one of the things, so this is an interesting method, but one of the sort of potential optimization methods is that Avira is one of the storage vendors, along with Cumulo and a few others, that are exposing some pretty useful APIs. Avira has an API that will tell you which portions of your file system are most active, and so the next generation of the system is probably going to ping the Avira to find out which directories should be the subject of an updated PWalk scan. So you're starting to see where APIs are coming in the environment, and they're starting to optimize what we do. And then the other thing is that this is painful. I expect to see more and more storage vendors, I think, are going to build this type of analytic capability into their platform. More of them are going to expose APIs for us to use. And then within the last couple of weeks, I got exposed to them. Again, the blue is hidden, but there's a company out here at dataframeworks.com. They've got a commercial product called Clarity Now, which looks like it solves that comprehensive file system walk and file system analytics method in a fairly clever way. And I expect to be hands-on with Clarity Now over the next couple of weeks. And you might see a BioIT World talk or something similar about this next year. If it saves me days of file system crawling and lots of development time, I'm all in on a commercial solution if it actually works for me. So back on the storage thing, I'm going to do a quick time check here. I'm still saying the future of scientific data at rest is object. It's a no-brainer. Again, I'm going to skip these slides from last year, but basically the differences between what you know about your files on a POSIX file system versus what you know about your files in a object storage where you can put in metadata, it's stark. It's very, very interesting. It's transformative to the enterprise. The ability to assign custom metadata to your scientific your scientific files and then query, sort, search, pull, and retrieve is frankly going to be transformative. It already is transformative. However, the nice thing about this is that we have hundreds, if not thousands, of legacy applications that still think of storage in a files and folder paradigm. So it's going to be a long tail transition. It might be a decade before all of us are on object storage native. So you can expect to see people who are doing storage refreshes now are probably going to start to bring in a little bit of object to sort of play with it. There's an emerging ecosystem of things like Avira, and there's all sorts of other gateway and storage devices that will put POSIX front end on top of object storage, meaning POSIX front ends meaning that they'll put NFS or SIFS on top of object. So if you want to kick the tires on object but not directly commit to object today, the use of object in your data center with some sort of POSIX layer on top is becoming sort of increasingly prevalent. So I would expect to see, you're going to see a lot more of these object gateways deployed in the field. And I'm starting to think that a lot of the movement towards object is going to come from the big commercial scientific software packages. I think imaging software, microscopy software, PAC systems, those types of things, those are going to be the things that will probably drive us to object sooner rather than later, because even for them, the benefits are extreme. All right, a little bit on cloud here. You can't have a BioIT World talk without the C word. And if you looked at how many cloud talks, you know, we're on the track here, it's a very, very interesting topic here. So just to recap the drivers, really, for me, cloud is not a cost play. Very few people save money running on the cloud. The cloud is more about a capability play. And then the biggest driver is actually data exchange and multi-party collaboration. The biggest changes we've seen in cloud has really been, there's a lot of hybrid cloud architectures coming out. There's a lot of multi-cloud design patterns. It's interesting if you talk to senior IT leadership about their Office 365 plans. In my world, we didn't really care a lot about Azure and sort of the Microsoft cloud stack, but when you're starting to approach this from an enterprise perspective, and you realize that the enterprise is probably going to go Office 365 and there's going to be no more Active Directory servers on-prem anymore, already you're at a multi-cloud environment if your science is in Amazon or Google, and Office 365 is where all of your identity and access sort of authorization lives as well. The other thing that's happening is more and more of our clients are procuring direct connectivity into cloud environments. They're connecting into 1 gig and 10 gig. I think there's probably 8 or 9 that I can name, whereas last year I think there was 2 that I can name. So it's definitely been a sort of big trend. The other thing that this is actually brand new and it didn't come up last year. I think BioTeam, it's a safe prediction, is we're sort of calling it a new era of cloud sobriety. I'm going to stand up here on stage here and say that there's going to be at least 1 to 3 major pullbacks from the cloud in 2016. The biggest driver is, again, C-level executives buying into the hype and shouting cloud first without being able to do math. The other driver is that we've been operating in production on cloud environments for a long enough time that we have actionable cost data. We know what it costs. We know what all of the data egress and ingress charges are doing. And we're finding out that there are certain workloads where simply it's not cost effective. And I think you're going to see a little bit of clawback in a couple of sort of unique workflow environment. And finally, there's been enough interest on the sort of commoditization of storage and compute that if you're looking at a recurring monthly cloud storage bill of $100,000 a month, on-prem storage starts to look a little bit more attractive. $1.2 million, you can do a lot of stuff year over year with that rather than spend $100,000 a month on a cloud storage provider. So I think the other interesting thing is I'm not necessarily ready to say that the cloud clawback is going to go all the way back to on-prem. If you're tied into the sort of supercomputing world and you're familiar with SDSC, NCSA, TAC in Texas, more and more of the government-funded or quasi-semi-public, semi-private government supercomputing sites, they're highly motivated to find revenue and become cost-neutral. And I think there is a significant possibility that you might see a withdrawal from the cloud and in deployment into some of the supercomputing sites. The cliche example, just because these guys are all over the place, would be like NCSA iForge, which is already renting out significant amounts of compute and storage to industry environments. So I'll go on record and say I'm fairly confident that there's going to be a couple of high-profile cloud pullbacks. They might be kept under the wraps because that might generate some news that the cloud providers might not want. But the interesting thing is where those workloads go. I'm not ready to commit and say that they're going to go on-prem. I think there'll be a mixture that will be pulled back on-prem, and you might start to see more and more of our commercial stuff running at UCSC, TAC, iForge, NCSA. And again, from an IT architecture perspective, that's multi-cloud or hybrid cloud. That's another remote data center that we've got to get our heads around, connect to, move data to, and secure. The other thing is, and this is a big one for cloud, is there is a new screening question you have to ask when you're looking at a cloud provider. The number one question you have to ask is, what are the chances that my cloud provider is going to create a pharmaceutical company and blow me out of the water? The second question you have to ask is, are there people secretly monitoring my API usage? Who are they talking to? Are they using this information to make my life easier, or am I just a guinea pig providing competitive intelligence to someone who's going to create a competing healthcare company and blow me out of the water? So this is not something I typically had to think about a couple of years ago. The trends and movements in the cloud space, and I'll just say again, just to limit fallout from this statement, this is my own personal opinion, but I'm starting to get concerned and suspicious in the cloud space, and I would encourage those of you who are looking at cloud vendors to add this to your screening list. You need to consider the possibility of a competitive risk when you pick a cloud environment, and that's all I'm going to say about that. So, or wrap it up then. So I'm going to recite. Actually, how am I doing on time? I'm supposed to go on. Okay, all right, so I think I'm okay on time. All right, so a little bit of this is recycled. The end is new, but it really is. I want to recycle these slides from last year because I think last year I said I was afraid that this was going to be the hardest part of my consulting work. It is absolutely confirmed that it is now the hardest part of my consulting work. So we've got this confluence of events. We've got the sort of diffusion of large-scale laboratory instrumentation spreading everywhere. We figured out that we've lost the battle to centralize this stuff, so it's impossible to centralize it. There's petabytes of interesting information on the internet where a scientist could make a legit request and want to bring it in-house. And finally, within our collaborators, our CROs, and our data providers, there's more petabytes. So we've got this problem of sort of terror petascale data spread, and we're coming to the grips with the fact that future of scientific computing at scale, our data and our compute is going to span sites, buildings, and probably multiple cloud environments. So this brings us into the word that I'm going to use repeatedly now, which is this sort of phrase, data-intensive science. And really what I'm leading up to, for those of you who haven't seen the slides from last year, is that it's all about networking. The overwhelming infrastructure hassle for 2016 and beyond is going to be network-based, because in order to do data-intensive science, we require a lot of complicated stuff, and we require a lot of brand new stuff. I'm not going to read the slides here, except I'll say the biggest pain points are the things that I highlighted in yellow. When you're moving high volumes of scientific data at scale, even fractional amounts of packet loss are catastrophic to the rate at which you can move data. I'm talking packet loss that would never even rise to the level of pinging the dashboard of the network enterprise team. I talk to network enterprise architects. They don't care about 1% packet loss. They don't care about 2% packet loss. In my world, 0.004% packet loss causes an 80% reduction in my data transfer throughput. So we have to build switches and routers that don't drop packets. And then finally, and this is the biggest pet peeve, is firewalls that claim they support 10 gig don't always support 10 gig. When you open the box on that 10 gig firewall, what you might find is 10 1 gig ASICs arranged in parallel. That works perfectly fine for an enterprise when you've got 3,000 employees making phone calls using WebEx and browsing the web. As soon as you try to run one big elephant flow at 10 gig speed through this instrument, it slams up against that 1 gig ASIC. All of the CPUs on the firewall peg to 99% utilization, and your throughput goes down by 90%. So I have a very big pet peeve with, and I'll just say, marketing lies related to the capabilities of enterprise firewalls. They are engineered for business flows. They are not engineered for high-scale, large-volume data movement, and you've got to get your head around that. And in some cases, that might involve switching your incumbent security platform if you're really going to buy into this at scale. So it all boils down to this, and I sort of talked over the slide here, is this is the slide recycle from last year that I was worried about that is absolutely true, is that the single biggest infrastructure challenge facing life science over the next couple of years is going to be terabyte scale data movement over wires. And that is building to building, lab to core, outside the firewall to collaborators, and outside the firewall to clouds. It's not even terabyte scale data movement within my campus or within my building. It's terabyte scale data movement potentially to clouds and collaborators as well. And I'm going to finish the talk sort of explaining just why this is a particularly nasty problem to solve relative to other storage, compute, and facility issues over time. So we've already talked about this a little bit, and I'll go a little bit quickly, but bluntly speaking, we built our network support to support business. We didn't build our networks to support large volumes of data transfers. So a lot of this stuff simply falls over when you try to move data at scale. The second issue is that the enterprise folks are looking at MPLS connections and external connectivity to the outside world. They're looking at it from saving the most amount of money possible, or they're buying incredibly expensive MPLS rings with 5 nines of uptime when people like me are demanding 1 gig or 10 gig connectivity to the internet. And so right now we've got this issue where the ratio of our connectivity to the outside world is badly out of whack. There are many of us in the room who need 1 gig or possibly even 10 gig connections to the outside world. That requirement has not risen to the level of attention of sort of senior network engineers and WAN folks. I've already talked about this here. It's not just within the data center. You've got to sort of have the ability to bring 10 gig or even 40 gig from building to building to a lab floor in a particular building, or possibly even to a particular instrument if you're talking, crazy microscopes or cryo-EM or, some of these massive data producing instruments. You might actually have a functional requirement to bring 10 or 40 gig directly to an instrument. And that is on nobody's enterprise networking roadmap these days. The other issue, and I talk about this a lot, is that I've blown up clusters, I've taken down petabytes of storage, I've pissed off many a scientist when I've screwed up the scientific computing environment. The blast radius is much bigger and the risks are much higher when you're messing around with networks. If you screw up the network, you take down the business. You take down the CIO who's on a link conference, at the time you push out that bad configuration. When you're messing with networks, the blast radius is bigger and the operational risk to the business. You have to be far more careful because the network touches everything. Previously, when I screwed up something, I just upset scientists. Now when I screw up something on the network, I upset the CIO, the CEO, and the whole enterprise. So a little bit on why this is going to be hard is the social and trust stuff is people like me have built up, you know, many year relationships with the server folks, the enterprise folks, the data center folks. I have to build those relationships from scratch with networking people and SecOps people and the risk management lawyers. And the first time they meet me, they just see a scruffy, you know, research nerd, you know, waxing on about 40 gig and 100 gig. And oftentimes they don't trust me. They don't think I know what the heck I'm talking about. And so you sort of have to, there's a new round of relationship building that needs to happen with the lawyers, the SecOps people, the firewall people, and the network people. The other issue is that in research, we've always had a very strong shadow IT bench. We have people who are amazing storage engineers, amazing server engineers, amazing DevOps engineers. However, in this sort of data-intensive science era, I'm finding I need people who understand BGP routing. I need people who understand how to get dark fiber and, you know, terminate it in a particular location. And the blunt truth is that I don't consider it appropriate for research to have those skills. I want my BGP expert and my dark fiber expert to be coming from the enterprise networking team. And so we don't have that expertise within research, and we're having trouble sort of making mean roads in enterprise to talk to those folks. The issue is cost, particularly if you're a Cisco shop. If you really want your mind blown, talk to Cisco about the cost of a 100 gig line card, and you'll see what that does to your budget right quick. I've already talked about the issues with firewalls and sort of incumbent vendors. So those are kind of a little bit of old slides. I've got some newer slides trying to sort of discern this into a little bit of practical advice here. So, you know, number one, we sort of have to acknowledge the fact that we're entering it's a new chapter, the sort of chapter of sort of data intensive science. We have to understand that we've got high data producers and high data consumers that are effectively diffusing throughout our organization, including beyond the boundaries of the firewall. And then finally, we have to recognize and come to the grips that some of the incumbent vendors, platforms, and technologies that we've been using for years might have to be swapped out. That's particularly true in sort of security controls and intrusion detection, but it applies elsewhere as well. So advice number one is start building those relationships. I think in the same way that the storage and server teams have been brought into the research computing family, we now have to reach out to the lawyers, the risk management, the SecOps, and the firewall people. I think we really need to reassess and survey the networking roadmap. One of the things that you'll find is that historically, the networking organizations are never well budgeted, they're never well resourced relative to research. Research, generally speaking, has been budgeted and resourced appropriately. And I would say to research leadership, if you want to make lifelong friends, what you really need to be doing is standing up on the research side and really championing and evangelizing that the organization needs to invest in network engineers, network hardware, network bandwidth, and new methods. Like I said, I think in research we're a little bit spoiled because budget-wise we have a little bit of a, it's much easier for us to justify our value to the organization and get the budget we need for exotic compute, exotic storage, exotic networking. It's a lot harder for the sort of mainstream network security and network engineering people to do that. And so there's a need for people like us to be championing that and shouting it and making sure that the network engineers are appropriately resourced, appropriately trained, and appropriately budgeted. Second thing is I think you need to sort of, you know, reassess the state of your campus and your organization. You've got to walk out to all of those dusty wet labs. You've got to talk to people about what they're procuring. You've got to look for that flow cytometer that all of a sudden became an image stream X and is now producing tons and tons of data. And you've got to actively seek out the people who are shipping disk drives around via FedEx. If you can intercept them and put a sort of better managed network-based data movement strategy in place, you'll be a little bit safer, and you also won't waste lots of time. One of my other pet peeves with network-based data movement is PhD-level scientists who spend 6 hours a day copying data from disk to disk. It's just a waste of their skills, and it's a waste of their resources. All right, what else? The other thing to mention, and hopefully some of you guys saw Dan's talk from Internet 2 yesterday, is the big change over the last 2 years is Internet 2, 100 gig research network, generally speaking, used to only be open to academics and government supercomputing networks. They're clearly open for business now. Biogen was one of the first public members. I can't name the other ones, but I know at least four or five other people who are connected up to Internet 2 in a commercial capacity. And so you're seeing an interesting trend. And if you buy into my argument that we need to increase our connectivity to the outside world, there's a lot of interesting things about Internet 2, not the least of which is that it's purpose-built for data-intensive science. So Internet 2 doesn't really drop packets. The other thing that's nice about Internet 2 is that I can use Internet 2 to get to Google, Amazon, and Azure. So if I'm buying a big fat pipe to the outside world, I might as well buy a big fat pipe that can get to my cloud providers or collaborators, my academic environments. The upside is, like I said, that 100 gig networking, not a purpose-built for data science. The downside to Internet 2 is that they're not really an ISP. It takes a little bit more work to connect up, particularly if you want sort of routable layer 3 access. there's some connectivity difficulties if you don't have a block of IPv4 IP addresses to bring to the game. I think there's going to be some movement around the I2 space where there might be data brokers or data aggregators who might step in between you and I2 and offer to provide the sort of, you know, give me a subnet mask, give me a default gateway, and just let me point my stuff at it. I2 is more of a just a pure connectivity thing. You have to think about routing, switching, BGP, you know, the 24 IP block that you're going to route, and all sorts of other things. So this brings up sort of the end, which is Science DMZ, and hopefully you've seen a lot about this or heard some talks about it over the last day or two. The data intensive era, and I'm trying to sort of brain dump Science DMZ right now, and it really comes down to is if you buy into what I'm saying about data intensive science and the difficulty of moving data at scale, we're at the point now where the realistic decision is it is now time to separate the business network from the data network. And whether that's a physically separate network or a logically separate network, that's a big deal. You know, we're talking about physically or logically building an entirely new set of networking infrastructure across organization. And that's a big philosophical shift, that's a big operational shift, and that requires lots and lots of high-level conversation among senior leadership and engineers as well. The other thing is that we have to stop thinking about life sciences as special snowflakes who are overwhelmed with infrastructure problems. The fact is that, you know, a high-energy physics person would look at our data movement needs and just laugh. They've got, you know, petabytes per minute being generated from some of these, you know, super collider type things. So what you're starting to find is that the high energy physics people have largely solved this problem. And the methods, concept, and philosophy that they're using is sort of being broadly grouped under this term Science DMZ. And again, without getting nerdy, Science DMZ really just boils down to physically or logically separating the business network from the scientific network. And the reason why BioTeam is talking about it is that it's real, it exists, it has high-level buy-in from the government, it has high-level buy-in from grant funding organizations. It's not BS, it's not owned by a vendor, it's not marketware, you know, there's multiple sites running it in production today. It works. This is how you sell Science DMZ in one image. So I talked about the catastrophic loss of data transfer throughput with, so this is a real-world graph from ESNet, and this is what happens to your data transfer at scale, at increasing distance, with 0.0046% packet loss. And remember, like I said, traditional enterprise organizations, they're probably not even going to notice packet loss lower than 1%. So the fact that you had 0.0046 would not even show up. No one's getting paged. No one's getting a dashboard. So this is the sort of come to Jesus or how to sell Science DMZ. You have to build networks that don't drop TCP packets if you're going to move vast amounts of data across a wire. So, you know, I've already talked about this thing. This is basically Science DMZ in a nutshell. Keep the data flows off of the business network. Build the networks that implement TCP correctly. Instrument the heck out of it via software or techniques called perf sonar. You have to grow up, you know, put on your big boy pants and step away from FTP, RSync, and SCP. There's a new set of data transfer software and tools that you use when you need to play at this level. And then finally, the big rethink is that if you look at the way people do intrusion detection and security at 10 gig and 40 gig and 100 gig networks, they're not using traditional firewalls. In many cases, they're not using firewalls at all. They're using switch routers and ACLs with out-of-band, you know, bro clusters doing real-time intrusion detection. When the bro cluster detects something weird, it sends an update to the router. That router does an ACL switch, and boom, you stop the bad actor. There's very, very interesting ways you can maintain high levels of security controls on your networking environment without putting an inline device that's doing deep packet inspection or sitting between you and the data. And typically the best practice involves, like I said, there's more of a switch router ACL practice going on with an optical tap that feeds something like a bro cluster. The bro cluster is integrated back to your switches and routers, so when your out-of-band security scanning system sees something weird, it doesn't have to push out a firewall rule, it just flips an ACL switch on the router, and all of a sudden you're dropping packets from the bad actor. So what we're doing in this space is, we're going to be talking a lot about this at our Converged IT Summit in October, and if you stop by the BioTeam booth, there's some brochures about that. But the other thing to mention is that we've got a 100 gig test lab hosted by TAC with a lot of hardware donated by vendors and friends. And what BioTeam's mission is because this stuff is expensive and exotic, it's really hard to buy 100 gig switches and line cards and optics and big flash arrays and data transfer nodes, is that we want to build a sort of open access lab, and we want to prototype out the Science DMZ design patterns, and we want to demo them, we want to offer remote login to you guys so you can test it out, and we want to start talking about it and writing white papers about it. And hopefully in our community we can sort of build out the sort of best practices in this world. And in particular, right this instant, if you come by a BioTeam booth or talk to Aspera or Adam Marco, every year for the past couple of years, we've always sort of given ourselves the challenge is how fast can we move data across the country? And right now, BioTeam, Intel, Aspera, and Internet2, we've got an experiment going on right now where we're trying to ship data at 100 gig across the internet, across Internet2. And what we've got here is I'm going to skip this because I'm a little bit worried about about time, but we've got 100 gig from TAC to NCSA. We've got Aspera running on top of Intel's data plane developers kit technology. And the blunt goal is, frankly, to see how fast can we move scientific data across the 100 gig network. A little bit of details on the hardware that we're using. If you really want to talk about it, we actually think right now we're rate limited by thermal cooling constraints on the CPUs. That's really where the issue might be right now. We've got multiple SSDs. We've got 340 gig line cards in this particular server. This is the sort of historical summary of what we've been able to do over the years. So back in 2013, we were doing this on 10 gig. The past couple of supercomputing conferences, we were playing on 40 gig and 80 gig networks. Today, BioIT 2016, we're doing it across a 100 gig network. And our goal is we think we can get to about 96 gigabits a second, but if you want the real world data, or possibly we might even be able to demo it live, I think you either stop by the Aspera booth or the BioTeam booth. And the current status here right now is, the last time I talked to the folks doing this is we're seeing 73 gigabits memory to memory. That's not a good comparison. We need to do disk to disk. So right now we're still optimizing and trying to get this thing as fast as possibly as we can, but we're at 73 gigabits memory to memory, and hopefully by the end of this conference we'll be able to tell you what we're at disk to disk. So that's it. That's the end of my talk. I know there's a contest or some sort of poll about how many slides I would do in 40 minutes. So I'll tell you, this is 120 slides. So, someone won. All right. Appreciate it. Thank you guys very much. I think we're over time and I'm blocking lunch. So let me get off the stage. All right.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
I was close. I was at 142 watts.